Drop shadows is something that we've been using for a long, long time. It's just that drop shadows have become so much more spread out, so much more subtle. If you look at the history of drop shadows, back in the days, you're gonna have a button like this one, either square or with minimal rounded corners. When I say back in the days, I mean like year 2000, 2010, and then you're gonna have something like white, and the drop shadows were super cheesy. So you're gonna have something that looked like this by default. And I remember if you use Photoshop, the drop shadow on Photoshop by default is 75% opacity, right? It looks like this and it's super cheesy. If you are starting out in design, typically you're gonna see a lot of these like very strong drop shadows, and it's really easy to fix, really. All you need to do is to move from a distracting drop shadows to something that is more subtle. And all you need to do is just to lower the opacity of the drop shadow to about 25% or even 15%. That is the first step. And this is like Web 2.0 drop shadows. It's not mind-blowing, it's very minimal. Sometimes you would have a 1-3, so 3 and then 1. So super clean. And if you look at a UI like Bootstrap, it's very much like that. And this is the era of Web 2. Now, Web 3, or at least kind of like if you see a lot of the new drop shadows, you're gonna see these drop shadows spread out a lot. So for example, you're gonna have something like 20 and 10. You know, if you look at Apple TV, for example, you're gonna see a lot of these super spread out drop shadows when it's selected or active. And it's gonna still use the gray. But then as we move forward more, you know, Apple and all of these, a lot of designers are starting to use more colored drop shadows. So something that represents more towards the background. So for example, if you have a blue background, let's say I have a colored background, like a dark blue background or a purple background like this one, and I would have my button on top of it. Instead of having just a black drop shadow, you would have a color drop shadow. I think it's gonna be more obvious if I make it lighter, because when you make it lighter, the drop shadow that is gray combines less well with the colored background. A better example, so you can see that the blending of the gray with the mid blue does not fit as well. Instead, what you can do is to use a level of vibrancy, and Apple has introduced that since iOS 7 with vibrancy. And so vibrancy is simply to use the drop shadow itself. So there's two ways to go about it. You can set a higher drop shadow, and if you leave it like that, it's super cheesy, but you can also use, for example, overlay. So now we have a drop shadow that is slightly colored and it blends much better with the background. So that's one way to do it, and I think that's probably the most flexible way. The second way to go about it is to use a color directly. So for example, you're gonna use the eyedropper and you're gonna eyedrop the color itself, and then you're gonna move to a darker tone. So you would manually select the darker tone of the drop shadow that fits. And this requires a little bit more experience, because then you have to kind of understand complementaries and colors and stuff like that, and monotone colors. And you need to sort of play, and it goes a lot with your gut to see what works and what doesn't work. So what I recommend is simply use maybe an overlay with black. That's quite easy to do. You can see that I can just use overlay. So you can see that the drop shadow is a lot more vibrant than this drop shadow without being super distracting. I think that's the goal. And if you want to make it less distracting, you can set it to 50% or 25%. Because we're using overlay, you need to make it with high opacity, otherwise it's not going to be visible at all. So 50% is fine. You can definitely use a drop shadow that is normal, but then you have to use the eyedropper, and then you can sort of like manually pick the right color. And typically the eyedropper is gonna use the correct hue, which is really important because the drop shadow has to fit with the environment. So the environment being the background. So you wanna make sure that we're selecting the same hue so it's gonna fit a little bit better. So now I can set a little bit more saturated. Now, if you look at these three examples, you can see that the gray fits less with the background. This one, you can see that it's a lot more vibrant. And this one is a little bit more in the middle, where the drop shadow blends much better and it's a lot more subtle, it's a lot more neutral. And I think you have to decide your level of comfort in terms of like how you play with that. Now, why do I spend like 5-10 minutes just discussing about drop shadows? Well, the reason why is because it's so important with all of these styles, regardless if you're using clay morphic, glass morphic, or normal or flat, you have to understand drop shadows. Now, there's a fourth one, and this is derived from the third example. The fourth one is when you have a colored button. So for example, you have a white background, which happens a lot, and you have a button that stands out, and that's great because you want buttons to stand out. Now the question is, should you use a drop shadow that is simply black like before and it's super cheesy? Should you use 25%? And that's more like web 2. So you can see that the drop shadow does not fit well with the button itself, the color of the button, right? So you can use the same hue. So for example, you can say, I want to use this drop shadow. I don't want it to just be gray or just use black with opacity. And so what you're going to use is the color of the button itself. And with that, you can use with opacity. And now you have a more vibrant glow. If you look at real life and you have like, let's say an AirPod that is, you know, very much colored, and you put that on a white table, you're going to see that the color of the AirPod is spreading on the table itself. That's kind of like what I like to call this like contextual drop shadow. It makes it really nice and it makes it a lot more vibrant than this. And you don't need to use exactly the same saturation. When I say saturation is how vibrant the color is. So for example, you can decide to have a drop shadow that is using the same hue, but you can move the saturation to be much lower. And so you're still retaining that contextual color, but it's not going to be as vibrant. And you can definitely also play with the blending mode, or you can play with the level of brightness and saturation and also the level of opacity. So if you compare this to this, you can see that even though it's about the same level of subtlety, the drop shadow here makes a lot more sense than the drop shadow here because it takes the context of the button itself. That's just something to keep in mind and to play with. And, you know, as usual, I'm not giving you like a full answer. I'm not saying that one is necessarily better than the other one. I'm just saying that if that is your goal, right? If that is what fits with your design, then you should definitely move towards that goal. And I'm just showing you the techniques and the reasoning behind those decisions and why we're using it this way.